Good morning. Welcome to Unity of Salem. Delighted to gather with you all this morning. I'd like to introduce, we have a new singer helping to lead our songs this morning. This is Carolyn Scholl. So delighted to have her. And we're always delighted to have Dale bringing the beat.
That's right.
I invite you to stand as you're able. Join us in singing God is Good All the Time.
Thank you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Unity of Salem. Wonderful to see you today. I'm the substitute teacher. Reverend Georgie was supposed to be here today, and she's not feeling well. And so I didn't have a day off, and I'm happy to be here. Always, because we are amazing. That's the truth. Wonderful song. Thank you so much for beginning our day. I'd like to welcome everyone here for the first time. Anyone here for the first time? There she is with Zeus and Nikki right in the back.
Yep, I'm Nikki and this is Zeus.
Yeah. Yay. And we also are welcoming friends from Marin, California. Unity in Marin. Yeah. Welcome, everyone. And we welcome anyone that's online watching us for the first time, watching us weekly. Thank you. Thank you. Just wave. See if they could see you. You could turn around and wave, I guess.
Oh, yeah, turn to.
So we're going to start with a few affirmations this morning. You are created in the image and likeness of God, and I invite you to stand in your spiritual power. I don't know how many people invite you to stand in your spiritual power. It is our true power. It is our nature. It is who and what we are. So today we stand, and every day, in our spiritual power. I am created in the image and likeness of God. Let's say it together. I am created in the image
and likeness of God.
I am a beloved expression of spirit.
I am a beloved expression of spirit.
I am here for a holy purpose.
I am here for a holy purpose.
I am in my right place.
I am in my right place.
Right now. Let's
right
say.
Now.
And that's the truth. We want to begin with a prayer this morning. And I like to set the intention. When I get up on Sunday morning and I'm making notes about my talk and I'm thinking about all of you and gathering here, I'm creating intentions. I'm creating the intention of joy and laughter and wonderful music and connections. So we hold those intentions. We also hold the intention that anything that is unlike our perfect self is dissolving. Anything that's heavy on the shoulder or the mind, we release today. Anything that is in my heart that I want to let go of. So I invite you to put your hand on your heart, and I pray. Spirit, moving in and through me as me. Divine order is established in our lives. We move with confidence and kindness. We ask for support and guidance. And so it is. Amen. Amen. Thank you, God.
As Joan brings forward the Christ light, join us in singing, Be the Love You Are.
Be the love. Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm Joan Riley, and I'm your Sunday assistant today. I have a few announcements. On March 2nd, we will have a Ukrainian Easter egg workshop. I'm leading it. It will be from 10 a.m. to about 2. The end time depends on you. Please bring your own brown bag lunch and have some fun. This will be on a love offering basis, and the sign-up sheet is in the back. And it's important. A few of you have talked to me about the class and have not signed up. We need to know how many supplies to bring, so please sign up. Our youth team is working hard to get the children's church up and running, and we thank them all for their hard work. If you have any questions, please see Bonnie Stabler, who's back in the corner there by the pillar. We have a registration form where you can share some of the things that our team should know about your child, grandchild. You will find the form on the table by the front door, and I think they've also been being passed out. We have a part-time cleaning position open here at the church. If you are interested, please talk to me, and I will have more information for you. Or if you're online and you're interested, call the office. We would gladly talk to you. Please join us. Come join us for hospitality, coffee, tea, and treats. They look good. In the kitchen area. Now let's join and sing I Release.
Actually, we're going to sing When I Walk.
Okay.
And I invite you to stand because you might need to step and move and groove a little bit for this one. Erin of Seattle Unity wrote this song, and she says it's way more fun when you're on your feet.
I can attest to that. I just learned it this morning.
Thank you.
We now join together in affirming the Unity of Salem mission statement. Unity of Salem nurtures spiritual growth in inclusive, loving community. And our vision statement, centered in spirit, we create a world of unlimited peace, love, and joy. Our core value, inclusiveness, spirit-led, compassion, love, joy, and integrity. And our affirmation, divine order is now established in all affairs at Unity of Say. And now I get to share the word of the day. Let go and let God. And our affirmation, I focus my attention on the truth of God and trust the best outcome is on its way. When I struggle with a difficult situation or a tough decision, I may feel awash with too many details and opinions. If I don't know how to move forward or what to decide, I release the situation and let go and let God. This simple yet powerful act puts my troubles and worries in perspective. No situation or circumstance is greater than God. Stepping away from effort and rumination, even for a few moments, helps me remember the truth. In prayer, I release the need for a specific outcome, trusting there is likely a solution of which my human mind cannot conceive. As I keep my thoughts and energy focused on God, I begin to relax. This creates space for divine grace and wisdom to lead to the best outcome for all. And from Ecclesiastes 3:6, a time to seek, a time to lose, a time to keep, and a time to throw away.
This song might be a little familiar to you, and you're welcome to join in and sing along if you'd like.
Is love, sweet love.
I love that song. What the world needs now is L-O-V-E. Immediately. We've been doing a series, this is our second week, on random acts of kindness then and now. And this is an incredible book filled with stories from around the world. And Trish has been reading it, a couple other people. Great way to start your day, to read about a kindness that occurred, whether it's in the U.S. or around the world. And I really like the focusing on kindness. Kindness is, I think it's different than charity. I think kindness is instinctual. And somewhere along the line, someone said, don't do that. Do you remember that sometime in your life when you were little or an adult? Don't trust people. Don't help people. And then there was that larger voice said, why not? Why not? We're all alike. We're all alike. So I am reminded that I was looking up random acts of kindness. I shared last week ministry I had in Lake Oswego. We started doing this over 20 years ago, and we took cookies to the police chief and his and the officers. We took things to the fire department. We supported a nonprofit of Project Pooch dogs in prisons, and we bought leashes and balls and, you know, the thing you throw the ball with and the treats and everything. And we found a lot of different ways to do kindness. We also took food to the food bank, which you do on a regular basis. So I'm just asking you to start thinking, is there something I could be doing I've been thinking about and haven't taken action on yet? So as I was looking up randomactsofkindness.org, there was a little blurb about scientific studies. So there's been scientific studies really on everything, including kindness. And what they have found is that science and kindness are relatable. Your kindness improves your love hormone, your serotonin, and it helps with your life expectancy. Who knew? Do you know if someone had told you that, you might have been a little kinder along the path. It also reduces blood pressure. It also reduces anxiety, stress. And a lot of doctors recommend kindness. Can you imagine a prescription that says kindness? Yes, I can. So how do I and you and we really be in action? It's one thing to think about it. It's another thing to do it within a community. And there is so much in our world that is asking for kindness. Yesterday, Paul and I were buying these beautiful daffodils. And a woman just stopped me and Paul and said, oh, a field of daffodils. Another one smiled and smiled and smiled. I still remember that smile. And it touched me. So when we reach out, when we acknowledge each other, when you give a wink, when you just, you know, give a hug, then there is the serotonin. There you go. You've lived one more day. The thermometer is going positive, not negative. So I have a story I'd like to tell you. I was a school teacher for many years, and I watched children and kindness. And many of us, as children, had best friends, had ways of going out and reaching out. So this is a story, this is a true story, about a family who owned a farm, and they were experiencing a drought in their area. And they had so little water that they could no longer use their water filter. Say it for me.
Water filtration.
Thank you. Water filtration, and they couldn't use their irrigation, that's it. And they were going to have to buy water in big trucks. and the water in the reservoir was running out, and there was only a day or two left for the farms in that area. Now, this mom is making lunch, looking out the window, making sandwiches for her husband and his brothers that are helping him. They're looking out the window, and there she sees her six-year-old son. And she sees him walking as slowly as she's ever seen anyone walk. This is not my child. What is wrong? And about 10 minutes later, he's running back as fast as he can. And then she sees him again. Walk into the woods. And she can't figure out what's going on. So what is a good mom going to do? Follow him, of course. So she's going to follow him. And she's sneaking, you know, she doesn't want him to know that she's following him. And they come to a little grove, and she's hiding behind the trees. And all of a sudden, she sees a large amount of adult deer. And then on the ground, a new fawn that is barely alive. And here comes her son with his little hands, bends down. He has drops of water in his little hands. And the deer licks those little drops of water. He knows she's there by now. And he says to her, Mom, I'm not wasting water. She said, I know you're not. And so she walked with him as he ran back, and she watched. And she went over to the spigot of the faucet on their house, and there was just a few drops of water that came out of that spigot. He held it in his hand. Mom went in and got a little bowl of water from the kitchen, and they went and gave that fawn a new life. We never know, do we? Now, this is a true story. We never know how we can change a life. We never know what a difference just a small act can mean. Last week, we had a few people share. We're going to do it again. Denita's standing over there. She's first. Come on up. Denita has a story she'd like to share.
It was the week before Christmas, and I was walking in the feed store. I don't pay much attention to Christmas, but I still had to feed my goats. So I had chosen already the things that I needed to buy, and I was in an aisle which was kind of a narrow aisle, and an old man came around the corner, and he had his head down. I don't know if I can speak through this and have my head down at the same time. And he came around the corner, and so he had this kind of wide basket. He was walking his head down and walking very slowly down the aisle. Well, there wasn't really quite enough room for me to just walk straight past him. And so I turned and went kind of sideways in order to pass him. And as he got close to me, his head tipped in closer to me. Actually, it touched my shoulder. And he said, Merry Christmas. And I giggled and said, thank you. And I have to tell you, I had a smile on my face, as big as it is right now, all day long. And I still think of that time a lot, just because it reminds me that just a little word, just a little kind word, can make a huge impact everywhere.
Thank you for that story. So Dick Thomas is our next one who's going to share.
Well, it started way back a long time ago. But what I want to say is that every morning I set my intention for the day to be a good example of peace, love, and kindness. And when Victoria mentioned she wanted to talk about random acts of kindness, I just thought, oh, wow. So many stories I could tell. But I'll make it really short. Some of you know that my second career in life was working at the state penitentiary with pretty hardened criminals. And I was blessed enough to have God in my heart all the time, and it was my intention to treat each and every person as a child of God that we are. And some, that was perfect for them. Some not. That was okay too. But not realizing that in doing that, and in realizing that they're the same children of God that I am, I was being kind to them. And it never really hit me until the day that I had my last day ready for retirement. And I was working in the furniture factory at the prison, and the inmates were coming into the office and wishing me well in my retirement and thanking me for the job that I did for them. And there was one man who was there that was in prison for murdering a person, and he was the maintenance man. Well, he and I, if you're familiar with the term, gearheads. And so we talked mechanics a lot. And he was just a nice guy, really. to know him, he was a really nice guy. Well, anyway, he kept holding back in the office. And finally, all the other inmates had left. And he walked up to me, and I looked him in the eyes, and they were just tearing. And he said to me, and he reached out and shook my hand. He said, "Thank you for the way that you treated me. It meant so much." And at that moment, I thought, all of this time, kindness won out. And I have a couple other stories, but I won't take the time now to tell, but very similar things with very hardened criminals that I was able to touch. And so I just want to say that kindness comes easy if you want to be loving and kind and peaceful in your heart, and it just flows out. So thank you.
Thanks, Dick.
I just want to say thank you for that story. That was incredible.
This is Carolyn.
Now I'm just tearing up. I really love this. So yeah, there's this store in Salem called The Trunk. Some ladies might know of it. It's a wonderful thrift store that I highly recommend going to. And it's on High Street in downtown, kind of near Macy's. And I got to know a little bit the lady that runs it. Her name is Rebecca. And Rebecca is this stunning person. She has this huge heart. She always is trying to help people, and like she's told me many things about herself just kind of going into her store. And so I went in there, a friend of mine was visiting me, and she needed clothes because she's like the front woman of a band, and she's like, well, maybe I could find some clothes in Salem. I'm all, yeah, I'm going to take you to The Trunk because Rebecca is going to set you up right now. She's really amazing. So I took my friend there, and Rebecca did set my friend up with a lot of really excellent new clothes for gigs, which my friend was ecstatic about. And you know, it's like the slow time, January. This is when this was. And so she was like, and she doesn't make a lot of money. She's about to move because she's not really making enough money with the store. And so she's having a 50% off sale of certain things. And I bought one of these things that was supposed to be discounted. And it was $5, you know. And I'm like, I'm not going to pay $2.50. That's ridiculous. I'm going to give her $5. And so it came time to pay. And I'm like, here's my, you know, I gave her a $5 bill, and she was like, oh no, it's $2.50. And I was like, no, here. And she was like, she was kind of like, she couldn't believe it was happening. I'm all, take my money, Rebecca, you know? And she was like, wow. And she just kind of, it was kind of like she just kind of sat back and was really, just really, like, felt a lot about the fact that I did that. And it was beautiful. And it's true. It's like the smallest things are really impactful to us humans, you know, so.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Mariah's next.
Morning, everybody. I'm Linda. And I've been thinking about maybe sharing this since last week's message that I watched from home, and I've talked myself into it and out of it many, many times. I'm real comfortable with prepared remarks, but off the top of my head, it's really out of my comfort zone. So here we go. Okay, paying it forward. Got an idea, not an original idea, maybe 4 or 5 years ago, based on stories I had heard about people going through the drive-thru at a fast food place and paying for the person behind them. And not taking their food too, just paying for them so that when they come up, I've heard that too. But just paying for their food. So I thought, okay, well, I'm gonna, on our weekly trip to Winco, I'm gonna try that. I'm just going to surreptitiously ask the checker to give them $10 or $20 and just say, can you put this toward the next person's order? And sometimes the checker was a little, but they finally understood what I was trying to do. And the point was that I did not want them to know who it was, because it's, I think, something Reverend Victoria said last week about it's not necessarily about getting gratitude directly for it. That's not the point. And I did this maybe 7 or 8 times, and then COVID hit, and I didn't go to the store, and then I was terrified of everyone for a couple of years. So I haven't done it since, but it was pretty cool there for a while. My strategy here, it changed. At first I would look at the people behind me and not make a judgment, but say, well, could this help them? But then I realized really quickly that wasn't what it was about at all. It didn't matter. And there's no way you can tell, oh, they probably need 10 bucks. Yeah. Who knows? And it wasn't the point. It was, okay, I just want to slink away and let them kind of go, somebody who I don't even know just gave me money to help me for absolutely no reason. And I'm hoping that they weren't offended by that or it didn't confound them, but that they kind of thought, wow, that's pretty cool. And maybe, if it stops right there, it's fine, but maybe they would go, oh, well, maybe I can pay that forward too. So it was pretty cool. It was very enjoyable.
Thank you. For being great. And Mariah. Now you realize I didn't get to ask these people a week ago. I called them yesterday. So everybody's doing a really good job of just telling their story.
Thank you for asking me.
Mm-hmm.
I have two brief stories to share. One was quite a while ago when I was going through a pretty tough time. I was getting a divorce. There was a lot of upheaval in my life, and my oldest son, I felt like for him and I both, we needed to have a separation, a break. So he went and stayed with some family friends and lived there for a while. Well, in that process, he was in an ATV accident, severely hurt, rushed to the hospital, and a lot of things needed to happen. Well, after a day when they realized that simple medication wasn't going to help, then he came back to the hospital. They airlifted him up to Seattle to one hospital and then to another. Long story short, he had gangrene in the cuts on the back of his head. And he ended up being hospitalized at Children's Hospital for about 7 to 10 days. Well, you can imagine the stress of separation from my children, going through a divorce, and now my child is hurt, my oldest child is hurt. So I had some friends who I asked, because I don't remember if I had a car even then, said, can you take me to the hospital with my son? And then during that whole process, he needed more care. So they took me to Seattle to help me take care of, you know, whatever I needed to be at the hospital. And you can stay at this hospital if your child is severely injured. So I just stayed there. And I had lots of people who were praying, because I told them. I said, we need help in this situation. I had people, I couldn't work, so I had people who were helping me with food and my family. But it wasn't just the people in my immediate family. It was my friends, my, you know, people that were part of my church as well, and people that I didn't know, that didn't know me, but that my friends all knew. My son had quite an amazing recovery. I was loaned a car and a place to stay when I got out of the situation for my son and I. And it was quite an amazing thing. I think I didn't really expect that I wouldn't get help. I just didn't know. I had to let it go because my son was the important thing only in that moment. And my parents came back even from a trip they were on to be there to support us. Well, that's kind of a really big deal that you don't always know how you're going to get through, but you do. The other thing I want to share is that we have people we know, people we've just met, our spouses, our children, and the littlest things can mean the most to the people we maybe take for granted the most and that we do rely on. Those are the kinds of things that can change your entire life, not just your day. So I've been blessed in a lot of ways, and I do give back because kindness is one of those things that can mean so much, and it doesn't take a whole lot. But you can share your heart, and believe me, it comes back, that little piece of you that you think you don't know how to do something, but trust and faith and kindness make a big difference.
Thank you. Love to hear personal stories. Now, I have a story to share with you. What do you think it's about? Oh, daffodils? Well, I have a favorite story, one of my favorites. I'm a collector of stories, I'll admit it. You know, people collect salt and pepper or, I don't know, antiques or whatever. I'm a collector of stories. I love a good story. And I wanted to tell this story last week because I wasn't going to be here this week and I couldn't find it last week. And so I'm here this week and I get to tell this story. Isn't it amazing that I just went when after Georgie had called me, I went directly and started looking through all my stories. And there was a file that said long stories. Now, I usually don't like to tell long stories on a Sunday. However, I picked up long stories, brought it with me, opened it up. First thing on that file was this story. I'm just saying, the universe works. I'm just laying that little seed, how spirit works in your life. So this story, true story, is about a mom and a daughter in California. The daughter lives in the mountains, the mom lives in the city, and the daughter makes a phone call and says, "Mom, I want you to come before the daffodils are over." And her mom said, "Well, you know, I'm busy." Anyone ever said, "Oh, I'm busy"? I am the only person in here who admits to saying, "I'm busy." So eventually, her daughter called again, and finally she drove to the mountains to where her daughter lives. Now, as she's driving, it's pouring down rain. The clouds are dark. She's thinking, what on earth am I doing? Eventually, she gets to her daughter's. She runs inside and says, "I'm going to hug you and the kids, and I'm turning back." She said, "No, Mom, no, no. Please stay." So she got dried off, sat down. She said, "Mom, I'm hoping you will drive me to get my car at the garage." Her mom said, oh, okay. So, but I'm not driving. No, daughter said, "I'll drive." So they get in the car, they start driving. 15 minutes later, she said, "I thought you said your car was at the garage that's very close." She said, "Oh, forget that, Mom. I want you to see the daffodils." So they kept driving and driving in and up the mountains. And eventually, out the corner of her eye, she saw a flash of yellow. What? As they kept driving up the mountain, more yellow daffodils. As far as the eye could see, in the mountains. And in the middle were beautiful purple hyacinths. And as they drove, it got wider and bigger. She started to have tears. In the most, what appeared to her to be forgotten place was beauty. Now, this series has been about random acts of kindness and senseless acts of beauty. When someone creates beauty that maybe no one will ever see. So they get out of the car, they start walking. Of course, it's just amazing. And there's a sign there that says, I know you have questions. 50,000 bulbs. One woman. Two hands, 2 feet. I started in 1958. And the woman who was with her daughter called that the daffodil principle. If each one of us would do something every day that would create beauty or kindness. And her mom was so touched, she said, what have I done with my life? What did I do daily to make a difference? What bulbs did I plant? What thoughts did I think? What acts did I do? And her daughter said, well, Mom, every day's a new day. So I'm asking you, if the daffodil principle ignites in you anything that says, I'm willing to think about more than myself. I'm willing to stretch my comfort zone. I'm willing to share in a way, just like Linda was talking, that nobody might ever know. Now, the woman didn't come out, and she wasn't a guide, she didn't show everyone her beautiful garden. There she was, creating beauty for whoever came by. No big advertisement. It wasn't on the internet or on television. And so I'm asking you and me, what is it that I am willing and ready to create? And what are we willing and ready to create here? We have wonderful land. Mariah is our landscape architect. We're looking at what are the wonderful things we can do here. We have a labyrinth idea. We have these many gardens. We have the peace pole. Whoa, what is it? Oh, it gives me chills when I think about it. I think, whoa. Possibilities. And the whole prayer series I did for 4 weeks was the willingness to see new possibilities. Am I willing to see new possibilities in my life and in this community? So we're going to take a moment in prayer. I invite you to close your eyes. If you feel comfortable putting your hand on your heart or opening your hands as a way of saying, I am open and receptive to my good. Wonderful thing about the universal presence is we feel it and experience it individually, and it is a collective consciousness. It is always more. God is always more. Breathing in and breathing out, softly, quietly, softly, quietly. Letting go of that which stands or appears to stand in my way or in the way of this community. We see it diminished, moving aside, and the heart leads the way. Show us the way. Show me the way. Through divine idea and intention, a connection. And in a few moments of silence, we go even deeper. We give thanks to the universal presence moving in and through our lives in ways that are surprising, uplifting, and healing. And we ask this in the name and through the power of all great spiritual teachers. And so it is. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Spirit. Thank you, everyone, for sharing your stories. Woohoo! Now, next Sunday is Surprise Sunday. I'm just saying. Be willing. Be willing. Oh, one person laughed. Good. Thank you, Ed. Yeah, everybody's all, what? This is our opportunity for the love offering, and so I invite our ushers to be prepared. And I invite you to hold your love offering, your gift, your tithe in your hands. These gifts are an outward demonstration of the love and the light that flows through us, out of us, into the world. This community is blessed by everyone sitting here, and we are so grateful. Let's say our affirmation together.
Divine love flowing in, through, and as me
blesses and multiplies all that I am, all that I have, all that I give, and all that I receive. Thank you, God. Pass the baskets, please.
Into the heavens and in.
And now we bless these gifts as the divine outpouring of the law of love. And as we give, we receive, multiplied, overflowing with abundance. We know that for Unity of Salem and for our personal lives. Amen. Amen. Thank you. And now, and Joan's going to be in charge and take the prayer box. And we're blessed the prayers. And there are a lot of prayers in here this week. And I know we have special prayers for Georgie and for John and Blythe and many others.
Twyla.
And Twyla. And Elizabeth is with Twyla at the urgent care. So we bless all of those who have turned to us in prayer and all of those that we know. And we see the divine law, energy, healing process occurring at all levels. And so it is. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And now before we go to the end, I have a little surprise. So Paul, would you just help me a little bit? I'd like the board to stand. You could stand now. That would be Jane and Kay and Jan. Elizabeth's not here, and Leslie. And Paul, if you would give each person a daffodil. Aww. Now they are. Okay, and then our staff, Garth and Angela. Garth, uh-huh. That would be you. And Angela and Trish. Come get a daffodil. And Joan. So to me, these are our daffodil representatives. That's a good word.
I need to take the candle.
Okay. Well, you can leave your daffodil right here.
Okay.
Paul's going to bring it to you. And we'll have extras. Thank you. Now, daffodils have a special place in my heart. The joy. These are from the grounds of the ministry where I was last in West Lynn. So we move it forward from there to here. Thank you, board. You have no idea how they represent you, how hard they work, the challenges they face, and what they've carried you through and are carrying you forward. Round of applause for the board. And then our staff, oh my goodness, day in, day out, keeps our heart beating. That's what they do. They keep the ministry's heart beating. So Joan and Garth and Angela and Trish over there. And Denita. Yes, you've got one here. All right, round of applause for our staff. Let's make a big circle, and she's going to carry the candle out. Circle up all the way over there, please. Keep going. Thank you. Keep going. Zeus, now give a round of applause to Zeus. He was so good. Oh, good job, Zeus. The dog, right, that's who the we're clapping for.
I see trees of green.
light of God
surrounds us.
The love of God
enfolds us.
The power of God
protects us.
The presence of God watches over us. Wherever we are, God is, and all is well. Please follow. Thank you, God. Please follow me in the prayer of transformation. The light of God is in me.
The light of God is in me.
The love of God moves through me.
The love of God moves through me.
The power of God transforms me.
The power of God transforms me.
The presence of God is who I am.
The presence of God is
who I am. Wherever I go.
Wherever I go.
God is.
God is.
And all is well. Thank you, God. Please turn to the person next to you and say, so glad you were here today. Wouldn't have been the same without you.